Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for Quantum Today. I'm John Donahue, the Scientific Outreach Manager at the Institute for Quantum Computing. The IQC is a multidisciplinary research institute at the University of Waterloo studying the potential and development of quantum information science. We have researchers working on the cutting edge of physics, chemistry, mathematics, computer science, and engineering. And during Quantum Today, we'll be looking closer at the research happening at the quantum level. Throughout the talk today, do please feel free to ask any questions in the chat box, and we'll get to as many as possible before wrapping up. Before we get started, we do have one quick announcement. We're excited to be hosting the Quantum Connections Conference in person at IQC next week on May 3rd and 4th. This two-day conference will bring together experts from industry, government, and academia to discuss the growing quantum ecosystem and Canada's role in it. Find out more information on our website, and we hope to see you there. Today, we're diving into quantum foundations. Many of the theoretical results of quantum information science have surprising implications. For example, superdense coding allows us to effectively send two bits of information by physically transferring only one quantum bit. Now, many of these protocols are deceptively straightforward schematically if we just write down a quantum circuit, but transferring them from theory into something that can be experimentally realized is an art form in itself. One particular protocol of interest is quantum energy teleportation, which predicts that it is possible to extract energy from the lowest possible energy state of a system using entanglement and feed-forward information processing. These ideas have been around for over a decade, but in a recent result, a group of researchers from the University of Waterloo became the first to experimentally realize them in a molecular system with nuclear magnetic resonance. Here to discuss the result with us are two authors of the study. Eduardo Martin-Martinez is an associate professor at the University of Waterloo's Department of Applied Mathematics and an IQC associate. Hemant Katiyar is currently a senior engineer at IonQ, but until recently was a PhD student and then a postdoctoral fellow at the Institute for Quantum Computing, where this work was carried out. Eduardo and Hemant, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so we are talking about foundations, and whenever we start talking about foundational principles, it's really important that we define our terms incredibly carefully. So to a quantum thermodynamicist, Eduardo, I'll point this to you for starters. What is energy, and what does it mean to activate it?
Right, so I think that this is important. So energy, maybe it depends on what level you want to explain it, but let's put it like this. It's the ability, you can think of it as the ability of a physical system to do some work. So there's some tasks that we want to accomplish. You want to lift a weight, for example. That's a very thermodynamical example. For that you use batteries, in a way, a system that contains some energy, if you want, and that energy is the ability to use that energy to do some work. Now, what does it mean to activate it? Well, most cases to transform energy into work, to actually do work with energy, that's very tough. In fact, we know from thermodynamics that that cannot be done, for example, with 100% efficiency all the time. There are thermodynamic limits. The laws of physics put limits, the second law of thermodynamics in particular, put limits on how efficiently you can do it. Activating the energy in a way is a passive state. For example, if you have a hot bath, a thermal bath, that is a passive state, meaning that it's an equilibrium state. Anything that you do to it is going to cost you energy. You're not going to be able to extract work from it. Activating is doing something to the system that removes this property of being passive, this property of being unable to extract work from it. So things may contain a lot of energy, but then they may be passive. So I'm not able to transform it into work. When I make them active, if you want, or I'm not passive anymore, means that I am going to be able to extract energy from it. Yeah. That's more or less the very hand-wavy, hopefully understandable notion.
Yeah, so when we talk about passive states, something like a state in thermal equilibrium is something that's relatively common to encounter physically. The work that you're particularly working on is a little stronger than just the term passive. We talk about states that are strong local passive, particularly, of course, talking about quantum states that are strong local passive. What properties make a quantum state strong local passive? And is this a common situation, or are we talking about something really specific here?
It is very common. So of course, not everything is every system in any state that you can find is strong local passive. But strong local passive is stronger. So and weaker in both senses. So passive means in the notion of quantum mechanics, passive means that it's a system that there's no unitary operation that we can do on the system that can extract work from it. Strong passive without the local part would mean that there's no operation, not only unitaries, but any quantum channel that you can think of would not be able to extract work. Any operation that you do to it cannot extract work. Now, local passive, or strong local passive rather, means that any local operation that you do in the system, so imagine a many-body system, a system made of many small constituents, like a macroscopic system made of many molecules, meaning that any operation that you do locally on a small bunch of molecules will not be able to extract work. A typical example that I give is it's actually a pretty cool one, the sun. The sun is, in a way, well, I mean, the ionization of the sun is a strong local passive. It's a very hot object, so you know that if you touch it, if you touch the sun for a little while, you're going to get burnt. However, if you touch the sun very fast, if you do something, that's the local part, if you touch it for a long time, it's going to equilibrate, so you're going to do an operation that is transmitting the flows of energy from the whole system. But if you touch only locally, you touch only one molecule or a couple molecules for a little bit like this, it may happen that you actually get colder instead of getting burnt because of the property of strong local passivity. If it's in a thermal state, it's going to be strong local passive. The thermal states are strong local passive, so if you only touch it for a short time, if you only touch it in an operation that is very local, that there's no flow of energy from the whole system, you can also get colder. So this is an example of strong local passive. And many, many systems are in strong local passive states, in particular thermal states, and of course the ground state. If you put something in absolute zero, which is a particular example of a thermal state, the ground state of something, the vacuum in a quantum field theory, for example, that is also strong local passive. And I think that's what we're going to focus on today, right? Doing the strong local passivity breakdown of ground states, perhaps. This is the most interesting, maybe, yeah.
All right, so now I do see an upcoming grant application from you to experimentally test touching the sun one molecule at a time, but that's for another day.
I need to pass the test of human experimentation for that, right? So I don't know if that's okay.
We'll get there. So now that we have that kind of framework in mind, let's address the elephant in the room. Today we're talking about quantum energy teleportation. What kind of protocol is that? What does it accomplish, and where does this idea come from?
So that's for me as well? Or for
me? Yes, sorry.
So quantum energy teleportation is a very interesting protocol. So the protocol is the brainchild of Professor Masahiro Hota, who's a professor in Tohoku University in Sendai, in Japan. Masahiro Hota was looking, in fact, this was actually born out of trying to understand black hole physics in the context of quantum field theory. So extremely interesting origins. And he was looking at perhaps the presence of negative energy densities, and we may talk more about this, what that means. So you have zero energy somehow creating negative energy densities. He was thinking, oh, we know that in black hole physics, there's phenomena, right, that is related to negative energy densities in QFT, quantum field theory. And he thought, but we also know that entanglement plays a very fundamental role in black hole physics. So perhaps the presence of negative energy densities can be associated with entanglement. So he was trying to prove that that you cannot use LOCC, which is local operations and classical communication, which is something that cannot increase entanglement, that he was trying to prove that LOCC cannot be used to extract energy from a passive state, to activate a passive state. And he actually proved the opposite. He was very surprised. And that's how he started. And it took a long, long time for people to actually, it took a while, I guess, for the community to actually recognize it as a very interesting thing, because it felt very esoteric to many people. I guess maybe we will talk more about that. Very too connected or too close to zero point energy extraction, which is a very famous crack pottery device that people have used in the past. So because it sounds too close to that, because I think it's as close as you can get to that, actually. So because it sounds too close to that, many people looked at it very skeptically. So it took a long time until people realized, this is extremely interesting. And then applications and things started to branch out a lot from that. So that's the origin of it. That's where you can. I don't know if that was what you were asking about.
No, absolutely. I do want to kind of go back one step, though. You mentioned negative energy densities, and you were very explicit about using not negative energy, but negative energy density. Right. How can we have a negative energy density, and how does that, what about that specific term density means that, you know, does that prevent us from actually having real negative energy?
Yeah, for sure. So negative energy density is what the word says. So a density, mass density is mass per unit volume. Mm-hmm. Energy density is energy per unit volume. So it's very much the same thing. And the energy density, so for example, if you have the, say, the electromagnetic field, you have the ground state, the energy is obviously, well, zero. I mean, neglecting the 0 point energy is zero, and then you have zero energy. But then you can do operations on it that locally makes the energy density, the energy per unit volume, negative in this area, but then positive around it. So that when you integrate over the whole volume, you get positive energy. If you are in the ground state and you do something to the ground state, the total energy is going to increase. So the integral, the sum over all the volume of the energy density will increase. We go from zero to something else. However, in local regions, in regions that are smaller, you can have negative energy densities there. So you certainly have negative energy densities. And in fact, you would even expect them to gravitate as negative energy densities. And maybe when you ask me about applications of this, I may talk about that a bit more. But yeah, no, negative energy density means that locally, you can have regions with negative energy if you integrate or sum over the volume of that region, paying the price that around it, you're going to have positive energy around it. But yeah, yeah, you can have negative energy densities, yes.
Oh, all right. So we are going to be talking more about the specific protocol, but when we talk about quantum energy teleportation, we do encounter the fact that a very common protocol in quantum information science is quantum state teleportation. So to help us understand exactly what the quantum energy teleportation protocol does, can you contrast it with maybe a protocol that others might be more familiar with?
I think, okay, there are some people, not me, I like the name actually, but there are some people that object to the name because I think can be misleading because of the confusion with quantum teleportation. So you see, the protocol of quantum teleportation to begin with is not a quantum thermodynamics protocol in the sense that people don't care about energy balances and flows. This is the main thing, right? They both use similar resources in the sense that in ground state quantum energy teleportation, you need to have entanglement. And for quantum teleportation, you need to have entanglement as a resource to use it. But in quantum teleportation, it's a purely quantum informational protocol. It's a protocol to send quantum information. Whereas quantum energy teleportation is a thermodynamics protocol. We're not sending quantum states. We're actually not sending quantum information. We are sending classical information and extracted energy. So in a way, one is a thermodynamics protocol, if you want, or quantum thermodynamics protocol. It's quantum informational indeed, but it's taking into account energy balance and so on. In quantum teleportation, you don't care about energy balances. You're just transmitting quantum information. And the cost, whoever's gonna foot the bill, we don't care. Here in quantum energy teleportation, it's important who's gonna pay the bill and who's gonna get the benefits from it energetically. I don't know if that helps, hopefully.
No, absolutely, absolutely. So it's kind of we're looking through a very different lens than when we normally might encounter the term quantum teleportation. You did mention, though, that they both do rely on some similar resources, things like entanglement, these very specifically quantum properties. What about quantum energy teleportation makes this idea uniquely quantum mechanical? You mentioned it's classical information, classical feed forward. So what's like the big quantum idea here?
So there's several, right? I mean, again, maybe the most clear way to see that there's is generally quantum aspects of quantum energy teleportation is that you can do it with very cold thing, ground states, so fundamental states of many body systems. Classically, the ground state of something many body is, well, there's no energy. Classically, there's nothing, and you cannot do anything to it. You cannot activate energy. You don't have fluctuations at zero temperature if you want. There's no energy to extract. Also, there's no entanglement in the ground state. However, for quantum energy teleportation, what we use is that ground states of many body systems generically have entanglement in the ground state. That's most common. In fact, not having entanglement in a ground state is weird. What is common is to actually find entanglement in a ground state. A ground state meaning like if you cool something to absolute zero, a many body system, you're going to find that the system here and the system here are actually entangled. That's the most common thing to happen. Now, that entanglement is the resource that we are using for quantum energy teleportation. And there's always a pictorial way, and of course, excuses to, because that's not like fully rigorous if you want, but I think gives an idea. Think of the following. You have the ground state here and the ground state, you have the ground state of the whole system. And then you try to extract energy here. So of course, you know that you have quantum fluctuations of the system sometimes. Even when you measure, when you try to extract energy, sometimes you're going to catch a positive energy fluctuation, and sometimes you're going to catch a negative energy fluctuation. So sometimes you're going to be able to extract energy by chance. Sometimes you're going to actually have to pay energy when you try to extract energy by chance out of the quantum fluctuations of the system locally. So on average, if you do it many times for a long time, you're going to extract nothing, or you're going to have to pay in the end. However, now imagine that somebody is measuring the system somewhere else, and that somebody spends energy, as we said. Measuring the ground state locally will going to cost you energy, will cost you energy. So you pay the energy here. In exchange, what do you get? Information. You write down the outcome of your measurements, which is classical information. And you see, classically, that information gets you nothing. But because in a quantum system, we have entanglement in the ground state, the information you obtain here can now be sent to somebody else. And that somebody else could use that entanglement to be clever about interacting locally. It's like, okay, I'm going to catch only the good fluctuations. I'm going to do something here with the information that I got from here that will allow me to now extract energy, being clever about it, push the system back closer to the ground state. So you see, you use entanglement with the entanglement that you have, you know that the noise that was measured here is not random, even though it looks random. It is random locally, but it is also entangled with something that looks random here. So that information that you got here can be used by somebody else to extract energy.
Yeah. Oh, fantastic. Yeah, so the way it's described there, I think that gave us a really kind of nice, clear picture of the protocol. If we assume that we have kind of little Maxwell's demons-esque sort of figures who are communicating this. Now, in this result, you actually implemented this in a real experiment. So at this point, I'm going to turn over to Hemant. And the experiment looks a little something like this. So you implemented this in an NMR experiment. For those of who are a bit unfamiliar, what are the building blocks of this kind of, I'm assuming it's not actual little demon figures measuring and communicating.
Yeah, John. So what happens in this big machine you see on the left, there's a superconducting magnet over here, which produces a uniform magnetic field. And once you put your, and it's a very oversimplistic description of when you put your nuclei, where the name nuclear magnetic resonance comes from, if you put your nucleus in the magnetic field, the magnetic moment of your nucleus interacts with this external magnetic field. And since this is quantized, depending upon what your nuclear spin value is, or a way of saying, if you're not familiar with nuclear spin, it's actually angular momentum of your nucleus. So depending upon what your value of angular momentum of your nucleus is, the interaction describes how many discrete states you can have. So if you have a spin half or an angular momentum half nuclei, you can have two energy levels. And those energy levels are described by whether your magnetic moment aligns with your external magnetic field or anti-aligns with your external magnetic field. And what we do is we code one of them as state zero and the one as state one. So on the right, you see a picture of a molecule, and C1, C2, C3, and C4 refers to carbon nuclei, and they're actually carbon 13 nuclei because carbon 12 is spin zero, so it doesn't have any magnetic moment. And those are our four qubits. And then there are two extra qubits in there, which are hydrogens, which is connected to C3 and C2. The other hydrogens do play a part, but they're not currently important in this work.
Okay, so effectively what we're doing is we're taking this molecule, putting it in a really big magnetic field. We're seeing this kind of discretized steps in the angular momentum and using kind of each individual nuclei as our qubit at the mm-hmm. end of the day. So these are kind of our building blocks that we have. What makes this a good platform for this experiment in particular?
So one of the requirements is Eduardo said that the information transferred directly from one part of the system to another part of the system should be slower than when you transfer it classically. So you measure it and get the classical information, send it to another party, and then they do some local operation on their side to extract the energy. So for this work, we found that, okay, this molecule where A and B are not directly coupled, they have a small coupling, but that's smaller than A and. So AN stands for Ancilla, and A and B are two systems. So between A and Ancilla and between B and Ancilla, we have a way of faster mediation of your classical knowledge than from A to B. So that made it a good molecule. And a good platform is NMR has a good quantum control. So quantum control in a sense is, let's say you want your quantum bits to do something, how good you can control them to do these things. And we, in NMR, we do have a very good quantum control from years and years of research, which has been defined to let's say if I put a metric to it, zero being a bad control and one being a very good control, in NMR, we can get to 0.9999.
Yeah, no, the NMR, I understand, has been a very good system for these kind of things, precisely because we've been studying these control techniques since long before quantum information was kind of an inkling that people really had a particular interest in. But I do understand about NMR that there is a bit of a limitation in that we're only measuring things based on how the spins relax. And kind of the initial picture of the protocol we had, it'd be, you know, Alice makes a measurement here, sends information to Bob. But if we have to wait for the whole system to relax, it seems like we're going to have trouble implementing that feed forward. I get the feeling that Ancilla you mentioned is involved here. How do we kind of take these ideas that seem to rely on feed forward and implement them in something compatible with NMR?
That's a very good point, John. A limitation you mentioned can be overcome by using an Ancilla, as you have noted. So what one can do is encode the information of your working qubit to an Ancilla by using a control gate. So let's say if your Ancilla was in a zero state, sorry, if your system was in zero state and your Ancilla started with a zero state, and you apply a controlled NOT gate, which is controlled on your system and acting on your Ancilla. So in this case, Ancilla state will not be changed. So if you measure the Ancilla now, you see, okay, I get a zero value. That means that my system must have been zero value before applying the C NOT gate. Similarly, if it was in a one state, you'll get the Ancilla will get flipped to one because it will apply the NOT gate. And then you measure Ancilla, say, okay, that means before the application of your control gate, the system was in one state. And then it works similarly for a superposition of zero and one. But what happens here is in this experiment, you do a kind of a control operation between A and AN that encodes the information of your system A into Ancilla. And then you do a different control operation between Ancilla and B, which transfers the information to B. So it's kind of a mediated transfer using control gates.
Mm-hmm. I think we have the schematic right over here. So instead of taking it as this sort of feed forward, you're implementing it in a way that is fully compatible with unitary operations. No need for that feed forward. Mm-hmm. Awesome. So cutting to what you ultimately measured, did the results that you measured from this experiment match your expectations? Are there some challenges in actually implementing the circuit that might not be particularly obvious to people casually reading the paper?
Yeah. So we did ran a few iterations of the experiment before we settled on the final values. And the challenges were, so in order to apply these quantum gates in NMR quantum computing, what you do, you send an electromagnetic wave and that resonates with the, sorry, something just happened. Okay. So what happens is you send an electromagnetic wave to your nucleus, and then when it resonates, it has the same amount of energy as the energy gap between zero and one state. You apply a gate, and depending upon how long you mediate the how long you shine this electromagnetic wave on your nucleus, you get different kind of gates. Now the problem with this is the electronics required to produce this electromagnetic waves are not perfect. So whenever you're doing amount of when you're shining this electromagnetic wave, you're gonna induce some errors in there. Now, what the initial protocol was built upon on fully applying all gates using these electromagnetic waves, or common nomenclature is RF gates, because the frequency of this electromagnetic wave is in the RF region, radio frequency region. So now we had to come up with something that can reduce the amount of time we apply these electromagnetic waves on this nucleus. And one different thing which we haven't talked about NMR is that all the spins or all the qubits are coupled with each other permanently. So that is not affected by your electromagnetic waves. It's only affected by the properties of the molecule. And that value can be characterized very well. So there's a theorem in quantum computing that any gate you can decompose in terms of a C0 gate and a bunch of single qubit gates. And that's not necessarily true for C0 gate. You can have any two qubit gate or multi qubit gates. Having this interacting Hamiltonian gives us a many body gate. So now what we did was decompose these gates, which you see on the screen, in terms of single qubit gates and then the multi-qubit gate, which were essentially free in NMR because they're evolution under your natural Hamiltonian, and which is characterized very well. So only error that's coming from is applying the single qubit gate, which was done by using electromagnetic waves. So we had to make this adjustment to have a better fidelity experiment.
So yeah, really taking into account that in this molecule, you can't shut off the interactions between the different nuclei. You need to take that into account in order to make sure that you're actually measuring some of the results you intend at the end of the day. All right. So from the final results you got, and Eduardo and Hemant, do feel free to both jump in on this one. What about them shows to you directly that, yes, it was indeed quantum energy teleportation that you witnessed?
Yeah. So maybe if I can say... of course, with if you impose, if you do this protocol in a molecule, of course, if you do an operation on, say, A, to do the measurement part of the protocol, then that is going to inject energy into the molecule, and the energy will travel through the molecule, molecular bonds, and through the Hamiltonian that we have to B as well, and that's not teleportation, that's energy physically moving from one place to another. So the one important thing is to make sure that the whole time that it takes to do the protocol, so from making the measurement, sending the measurement to B, and then making the operation on B using that information, right? All that protocol has to take much less time, it should be much shorter than the time it would take for energy to travel from A to B. And the time is basically, more or less, the energy from A to B is about 1 second, 800 milliseconds, so. And the total time of the protocol is about, if Hemant, correct me if I'm wrong, about 30 something milliseconds. And that means that, of course, energy didn't have time to go from A to B in the regular way, the energy flow. So is the ground state, right? So locally looks like the ground state. You should not be able to extract energy from it. But now you extract energy from it, and you extract it much faster than the time it would have taken the energy to go from A to B. That means that the energy you're extracting is you activated that ground state energy. So this is quantum energy teleportation. Yeah. So energy really, is teleported, if you want.
Yeah, it really rules out that it propagated by normal means. It could not have made it that far in that time.
Exactly.
We do have a somewhat related question in the chat from Vincent. Generally speaking, is there any way that we can relate, how does quantum energy teleportation relate to kind of loss metrics that we would expect in other kinds of energy transfer? Is there anything that have, what kind of loss of energy did you have, and how does that relate?
So I'm seeing the question, and Vincent is citing the quantum teleportation with a limit of distance. So here it is true. So yes and no, it's a little bit cheating to think that you've been in the area loss, that the dispersion of the energy like that. Because you can also beat it with an optical fiber, right? If you send energy in an optical fiber, you don't have you don't dissolve the energy in a wavefront that is spherical. But what is done in that paper, which is actually super interesting, is enhance the entanglement. So instead of having the ground state, you have something called squeeze vacuum state. And that enhances the amount of entanglement in the ground state, which means that you can enhance the amount of, because you have more resources now, you can teleport more energy. And by squeezing the vacuum, right, you can actually overcome the decaying distance between the two. So it's a little bit of a trick that you can do, right? But saying that it beats the usual way of sending energy in terms of the dispersion, yeah, in a way, yes, because you need to send the classical information, and the classical information doesn't get dissolved, right? It can be cloned. You can send it to a whole wavefront, the same amount of information. You can broadcast classical information very easily. And in that sense, you don't have the decay. But we also know that entanglement in a many-body system decays with distance as well. So the entanglement between regions that are very close is going to be larger than the entanglement between regions that are very far away. So they're in a ground state, the resources that you have also decay with distance. So in a way, it's, you are still subject to constraints. Now, that doesn't mean that you cannot cheat it, right? Like in this paper that you mentioned, you can cheat those constraints by increasing your resources. In regular energy transmission, sure, you can too. You can transmit it on a lower dimensional fiber if you want, something like a very thin optical fiber, and then you don't get the dispersion with an area low, right? So, again, I don't know. I wouldn't see as a selling point that you can beat the regular energy transmission. There are other selling points in terms of the dispersion, but not that one, perhaps. Okay. But very interesting reference. Thank you. Yeah.
Broad picture sounds like there's still a lot of interesting work to be done in this field, both theoretically and if we can implement some of those ideas experimentally. We have another question from Rupayan Das. I guess related to some of the one thing that we normally hear about quantum mechanics in general is that when we measure something, we change the flux. We change that something. He's asking, when you measure the fluctuations, doesn't that change the statistical properties of those fluctuations?
Sure, but keep in mind that the measurement is made in A, right? So this is the important thing. You don't touch B. In this protocol, the measurement is made on A, and you are not touching B locally. So you are acquiring information on A, and you're sending that information to B, and you're acting on B. Now, these two things are entangled, but it's something very important to say. When you have an entangled state and you act on one of the partners, it is often said in popular science, you're modifying B directly, like you're doing action at a distance. You're not. There's strong correlation between them, and they have a classical analog. So you know that whatever you observe here is related to whatever's going to happen here. But you are not touching B. You're only touching A for the measurement. So even though, of course, you do something to A, that you're altering A, and in fact, you put in energy in A, you're spending energy there. That's why it's called teleportation. A spends energy. You send the information to B, but the measurement, you don't allow enough time, if you want, for the action made on A to propagate to B. So you're acting locally on B. B is not modified by the measurement on A.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you're changing, you're breaking the entangled state, but you're using those fluctuations effectively.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm always love these kind of experiments where it's like really interesting theory and working with experiments in the lab. Just kind of broadly speaking, how do these experiments come together? How do we get something that's so theory focused and then working with experimental researchers to actually implement it in the lab?
From my side, I can give the credit to Ray LaFlamme first, because you see, I brought the idea to Ray's group one day. Like I'm a fan of, I've been working in quantum energy teleportation and been always interested in that from the theory side. And I know that Ray LaFlamme is a person who is in between theory and experiments always. Like he was a theoretical physicist and still is, and he's now also an experimental physicist. So I pitched this idea to Ray and say, Ray, you do NMR experiments. Can this be done and so on? And then that's what started it for me from my side. From Hemant's side, what it would look like.
Yeah, I would echo your statement that Ray helps bridge the gap between experimentalists and physicists quite well. And from my side, I felt like the back and forth, the information I needed to do the experiment was readily translated into my language that I use. And I hope that the other way was true too, that I communicated what I did in experiment. And Nayeli also played a big role in that, in translating all the theory to a set of unitaries that can be applied in the experiment.
So Nayeli was, just to say, Nayeli was a PhD student at the time of course supervised with Ray and myself on the Swahinkamp. and Nayeli was exposed to the QET. We did a paper with on QET as well in quantum dynamics as an algorithmic cooling protocol with Ray and Nayeli and Achim as well. And then Nayeli was certainly fundamental. Nayeli was the one that talked with me, we talked theory, and then talked with him and then talked to him, and this is what you have. Nayeli would compute the unitaries, so we have to give credit to Nayeli as well.
Really the bridge in there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Awesome. All right, so we already did talk a bit about some of the kind of the next steps in the broader field. What are some of the next steps for you? What do you hope to kind of uncover? What are kind of some of the next things you hope to be working on related to this project? I'll start with Eduardo here.
Okay, so from my side, there are several things, right? From the theory side, which is, there's a project I have to also give props here to Boris Ragula and Thales Rick Birch, two of my graduate students. We're going to explore, so here's the interest. Negative energy is interesting in itself. So it's not the applied perspective. Let's talk more about the fundamental perspective. You can use this protocol to create negative energy densities. That's what we talked about. You have zero energy, right, if you want, and then you can apply the protocol to create negative energy densities. Now, there's something very interesting about how negative energy densities gravitate. So the gravitational field generated by regions of negative energy density. This is well known in relativity. In general relativity, there's something called energy conditions, which is, yeah, relativity allows for weird things to happen, so we're going to forbid them in a way. Where Hawking and Ellis came up with a series of conditions that matter has to satisfy in order not to create exotic space-time, solutions to Einstein equations that have properties that we don't want, right? However, quantum energy teleportation violates some of those. You can, with quantum theory, you can violate. It is well known that you can violate energy conditions. Wheeler and others have published a lot about if you have accelerated mirrors, you can create negative energy densities and things like those. However, those are not physical. You cannot really get a mirror and move it to a relativistic speed in real life. However, you can do quantum energy teleportation in a lab. You can actually do it. And you could create small distributions of negative energy. And then you can wonder what kind of space-times, if you want, what kind of gravitational field those negative energy densities could produce. For example, you could have repulsive gravity. That's a solution of Einstein equations. That's not the most exotic one you could have. If you go to the most exotic one, you have something called the Alcubierre reward drive. You can have like bubbles of space-time that can move with unlimited speed while you sit on them if you want. You can have wormholes. All those solutions of Einstein equations, those things that are predicted by the theory that we don't know well what they would work, because of course you need quantum matter to generate those, and we don't know how the gravity side of the equation behaves when you have quantum stuff in it. You can actually create those exotic distributions with quantum energy teleportation. So one of the objectives is to calculate the gravitational back reaction of that, which is fundamental research in quantum field theory in curved spacetimes, how these distributions gravitate. From the applied perspective, that's from the fundamental perspective. From the applied, and we are collaborating also with Eric Snetter, a researcher at Perimeter Institute in numerical gravity and numerical relativity. Now, there's also the applied perspectives in the sense that these protocols in thermodynamics, in quantum thermodynamics, allows you for literally transmission of energy by transmitted information. So you can actually share resources at the beginning, which is this entanglement that is ubiquitous. You can get from many different places, and you can enable transmission of energy without actually really having to propagate to physically travel from A to B. So imagine that you cannot run a cable to do the energy supply, right? You could, or a micro, imagine in a nano machine, right? You need to do work on this side, but this side you need energy to do the work, but you know there's no spatial room to transmit the energy. Well, you may be able to do it by transmitting information and doing a protocol of quantum energy teleportation. That's why I think implementing these things in molecules is a big step. Not only is the first experiment that shows quantum energy teleportation as a fundamental result, it's actually good to see that we can have controllable nano systems where we have enough control to implement these kinds of protocols, right? So, yeah, in my opinion, two kind of application, fundamental and in nanotechnology, if you want. And that's if you ask me. If you ask Masahiro Hota, for example, he will tell you the many things he's interested in doing as well.
Yeah. No, we did get a question in the chat during that time about how far-fetched it would be to actually use quantum energy teleportation for wireless energy transmission. Spend energy and information from here to get energy over here. Is that a pipe dream completely, or is that something that actually might be an application for real use? And
it might be, it might
year,
be
but eventually.
Not next year. So you see, this experiment proves that it can be done. You see, like maybe in a couple of decades, right, or something like that would be, yes, no, for sure. I don't think it's extremely far-fetched. I mean, of course, right now, typically in the scenarios where we need to transmit energy, typically there are better ways than doing QET. QET works, but there are easier ways typically than QET. When I say QET, I mean quantum energy teleportation. There are ways that are easier to do. But in particular, you can think of scenarios where that's not feasible to run a line transmitting energy, right? And move the energy from A to B and instead send information. It's certainly not far-fetched. The only reason why I think we are not going to do it tomorrow or the others is because for most cases, we have better ways to do it now. But you can also think of scenarios where the best way to do it is quantum mediated teleportation, and certainly not very far-fetched.
Awesome.
In my opinion.
All right, Hemant, you've taken a bit of a leap since this from academia into industry. But what are some of the ideas from the experimental side that you hope that people will build on?
Just before answering your question, I think I'll just add on to your previous question of what you think that this work should be in the future. So I learned a great lot while doing this experiment. I got exposed to new science, and thank you, Eduardo and Nayeli and Ray for this. And so in future, I will know how this field is progressing. I think Eduardo answered it very well. But from an experimental point of view, we would work on having a better characterization in your experiment, how to control your system very well. And maybe in future, we both overlap again. We can say, okay, we can do much better experiments now. And Eduardo will say, oh, we can do this, a better experiment. And then we can converge and say, okay, let's try a bigger experiment. And this way. And sorry, I forgot what was
here.
The industry.
Yeah. I think that's perfect. That sounds like there's still work to be done here. There's still kind of on both the theory and the experimental side.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right. So last question, Vincent in the chat actually asked an excellent question to kind of lead us into this. Are there any books or resources you would recommend for high school students or undergraduates really interested in this field, or more generally, if someone wants to do the kind of work that you do in the future, what should be the kind of things that they might be looking into?
So hopefully this summer. So I'm working with two collaborators, a student of mine, Erickson Choa, and a collaborator from Spain, Professor Luis Garay, on writing a book on relativistic quantum information. So it's in the works. Hopefully this summer will be done, so I can tell you. But right now there's no one work I would recommend. I could send you a list. If you're interested in that, feel free to contact me. I can send you a list of links and literature to read about relativistic quantum information. Is a very diverse field. There are many things. Keep in mind, relativistic quantum information is applications of quantum information theory to relativistic settings in the context of quantum field theory or in the context of times or regimes where relativity matters as well. So it's very diverse. You will find people ranging all the way from quantum optics to people ranging all the way to black hole physics and the black hole information loss problem and so on. So it's very diverse. So I can definitely give you some reference depending on what you're interested in the most on. Quantum energy teleportation touches everything. So it's a nice example of a relativistic quantum information protocol.
And Hemant, anything that you, if you were to encounter an undergraduate or high school student who was like, I want to get involved in this, what would you recommend they take a peek?
Let's see. A high school, IQC have many programs that that help with all throughout the high school to undergrad level and everything. So maybe that would be a good resource to start. And everything is recorded, if I understand correctly, right? So it's a great resource to go there.
There's one thing of resources. There's a course, there used to be at Perimeter Institute, I taught for some years a course on relativistic quantum information, introduction to, and it's recorded too, with some Pearson, which is the Perimeter Institute repository of videos. You can find it there. If you're interested in that, you can watch it. The course requires only assumes that you know a little bit of, you know quantum mechanics, that's what it assumes. You're familiar and happy with quantum mechanics, and doesn't assume much more. It's a little bit of quantum field theory, but not a lot. So you can watch that too for relativistic quantum information. And as Hemant said, there's plenty of resources at Waterloo that's a video that I've recorded. Everyone can watch it.
Thank you for those. We'll make sure to post those links in the comments below after the recording. All right. With that, I think we have reached the end. Hemant and Eduardo, thank you so much for joining us today. It has been an absolute pleasure to talk about some very interesting foundations and some very concrete ways that we can actually make them happen.
Thank you, John. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about this. It's always great. Yeah. And thank you, Hemant, as well.
Yeah, thank you, John. It was nice to have a chat about the work. And thank you, Eduardo. And that's it. Thanks to Ray and Nayeli, too.
Indeed. Totally. Without Nayeli and Ray, this world would not exist, right? So it's very important. Yeah.
Yes. Oh. Thank you for mentioning that. And yeah, thank you once again. Thank you to everyone who joined us today. Thank you for the questions in the chat. Do please look up this result. You can find an open access version on the archive or the published version on Physical Review Letters. We will be taking a bit of a summer break from Quantum today as we implement some of those workshops over the summer. But we do keep an eye on our social channels and we'll be announcing more additions as the summer keeps going. So I hope everyone has a wonderful spring. Thank you again for joining us and have a absolutely wonderful day. Thanks again.